Hey everyone, I'm audible, right? Just a check. Raise your hand if I'm audible. Great. So welcome to the smart lock talk, where we're going to talk about how we pwned or hacked a smart lock using Python. So before we dive into the lock and all the technical stuff, let's get the boring stuff out of the way.
So hello, can everyone hear me? Yeah. So I'm Raghav. I'm a computer science undergrad from SRM. I'm basically interested in security and specialize in hardware security. I also dabble in reverse engineering and coding a little.
I'm Anirudh. I'm a computer science undergrad at SRM too. I'm in my third year right now. So I generally do security stuff. I'm interested in the embedded side of security. So like, you know, routers and small devices. And I also like dealing with the large-scale security, like operational, applied intelligence analysis, and tradecraft techniques. So before we, you know, get into the lock itself, let's take a quick look at the IoT security scene in general today.
We as humans have basically surrounded ourselves with tons of IoT devices, ranging from routers, set-top boxes, smart fridges, smart TVs, and whatnot. But when it comes to security, it's bad.
It's pretty bad, right? So the security measures that you see that are implemented in these devices are over 20 years old. So you see stuff like, you know, executable stack segments, which means binary exploitation is trivial. You can just smash through the stack. There's no canary, there's no ASLR. So binary exploitation becomes super trivial, so you can, you know, there's no need for convoluted techniques like return-oriented programming or return-to-libc attacks. And you see unencrypted communications amongst these devices, so you see, you know, locks and whatnot, and, you know, communicating in plain text. And then you find hard-coded credentials in firmwares, you see hard-coded tokens, hard-coded passwords. And the binaries that are used in these firmware images are generally, you know, it's a developer-centric conference, right? So everyone knows how developers generally work. You basically pull source code for existing, you know, stuff. So people, so in firmware that you see today, you see GNU Core Utils samples, but most of it is stripped down by developers to, you know, make it smaller and, you know, compact for IoT-specific applications. So this stripping down process eventually leads to a ton of nasty bugs.
So before we dive into our specific lock, we would like to establish a few points of what we expect from a smart lock in general. So we expect a smart lock to have a capacity to lock and unlock using fingerprint. Can be, again, use lock and unlock via Bluetooth and also come with a companion app. As a package.
So this companion app, right? So it generally has a bunch of, you know, actions that, you know, the user can perform, which is to configure users, you know, add and remove users, add fingerprints to unlock the lock. And it almost always requires you to sign up for an account with your service, right? So they all have like this big, you know, company that they build around this, and you have to sign up for an account with their online platform or whatnot.
So our specific lock is called the FB50. We bought it off Amazon and we bought it for around $3,000. Similar locks were sold by multiple vendors. It was basically the same lock but sold with different names. And the mobile companion app that came with the lock was called OK Lock. And this is how it looked.
So this is what it looks like. The front of the lock is the fingerprint sensor, and the back, it comes with a QR code that you can use to pair with. The QR code was stuck by Raghav, so if you're wondering why it's so terribly stuck, it's him. So let's talk about our initial approach. So when we are present at the lock, it's a black box, right? So we don't really know what to do with it. So we're going to give you an idea of how we approach the lock from a hardware security research perspective.
So the first surface that we explored was the Bluetooth, because as hardware researchers, we tend to go to the easiest surface. And initially, we tried to get a dump of our Bluetooth communication between our mobile phones and the lock and replay the packets.
Yeah, so how we did this was using two primary methods. So Android, if you're aware, has a HCI dump log, which you can grab by enabling it in developer options. So that's what we did. We turned on the dump, and we grabbed these packets as the app and the lock communicated. So we identified what packets caused an unlock caused an unlock from the phone to the lock. And we attempted to replay those packets, and that didn't really work. So the next approach we tried was performing a man-in-the-middle attack using a tool called Gattacker. So Gattacker is essentially, it's a tool that you can install on a Raspberry Pi. And so the Gattacker basically makes the Raspberry Pi behave as a third party in between your phone and your lock. So here our Raspberry Pi acts as the lock to the phone and acts as the phone to the lock. So if that makes sense. But you know, our luck was terrible and it really didn't work. It crashed every time we tried connecting the lock to the Raspberry Pi. But yeah, so we moved on to reverse engineering the app itself. So we use the textbook method for Android reverse engineering, right? So you Google Android APK reverse engineering, this is what you're gonna find. So there are three main tools that we used, APK tool, Dexterjar, and JDGY. So APK tool basically converts your binary APK package into something called as Dex files. So Dex files are compiled bytecode that runs on the Android Dalvik virtual machine. But that's not, it's intermediate code, it's bytecode, you can't read it. So we convert it into a JAR, jar, which is a Java archive file, using a tool called Dexterjar, and we visualized it into, you know, a lot more readable code using JDGY, which is your Java disassembler. So most of it was obfuscated because, but we did find a couple of hard-coded keys and tokens and a couple of API endpoints. But it didn't really make much sense then, so we ditched it and moved on to the, you know, the next obvious approach, which was a lot more easier.
So the next surface that we approached was the communications between the server and the mobile application. And this actually worked. We used a tool called Burp Suite, and we basically rerouted our mobile traffic through my laptop.
Yeah, so if anyone's done web security or bug bounty hunting, everyone knows Burp Suite. It's like the go-to tool for intercepting HTTP traffic and messing around with input. So when we were doing this, we came across a lot of requests, but we filtered all of it down to a couple of interesting ones.
But before we go into the requests, we also found some interesting data that was being sent in these requests. One of them in particular was a token that was being assigned by the server to a user when he logged in.
So this token essentially states that, hey, this user is authenticated and he can unlock this lock.
Yeah, he can bind or unbind the log, basically. Unbind with the log.
Right. So there are two basic pairing mechanisms.
The first one is obviously via Bluetooth, and while attempting to pair the mobile with a Bluetooth, the app sent the MAC address of the lock to the server, and in response we got a huge JSON file dump.
We got this massive JSON dump. So not all of it is relevant, but we've highlighted what is actually important. So in what we use further on is the barcode, which we got. And then we got an ID, which we figured out was the lock ID. And then a lock key, which we didn't know what it was then, but it turns out it was the AES key. And a lock password, which was being used by the app internally while pairing with the lock. So if anyone's worked with Bluetooth before, you know that you have to send a pairing code, which was six zeros. And then the name of the lock itself, which we set. We were very creative with the name.
And then using the second method was pairing via barcode. And again, it sent the barcode in a post request. And in response, we got a similar JSON dump, only with a key few differences. One was the email ID and a user ID. So just to be clear, the user ID and the lock ID are two different IDs. User ID is the account's user ID, and the lock ID is the lock's ID in general.
So that was the JSON dump. And so now there are two you know, other features of the app that we're going to put forth. So we, so every user can bind and unbind, you know, to the lock, right? So a binding, binding a lock was, it basically says, hey, this user is tied to this lock, and that user can add more, you know, other users to, you know, bind with the lock, right? So while sending an unbind request from the app, we noticed that the lock ID and the user ID were being sent. Now, both of these details we can we obtained from the previous you know, two requests that we talked about. And while binding, we specify a name for the lock, which is you know, again, new name, creativity, and the user ID, and the MAC address. Now, just to be clear, we're talking from the attacker's perspective here. So the new name is being set by the attacker. The user ID is the attacker's user ID, right? So he wants to transfer ownership of the lock to his own account. So the user ID which he specifies is his own user ID, which you can obtain by, you know, logging in on the app, and you know, you can figure it out. And the MAC address can be obtained from an attacker's perspective again by performing a simple Bluetooth scan in the vicinity of the lock.
Okay, so the bug that we finally exploited was tokens. Even though the tokens were being checked or verified, the tokens were not being bound to a particular account. That led us to, like, use someone else's token to bind and unbind a lock. So basically, allowing transfer of ownership of the lock.
Right. So now the exploit, it's simple. So it's basically what the request that we talked about earlier. Well, I'm just going to put it all in a couple of points. So it was a simple four-step process, right? So we initially get the barcode and the lock ID using the lock's MAC address, the first request. And using the barcode, we fetch the user ID of the legitimate user. And using the lock ID and the user ID, we unbind the current user, you know, the user who owns the lock, from the lock. And then we supply a new name, name it whatever you want, a new user ID, which is the attacker's, and the MAC address of the lock itself. And we, you know, thereby bind our own user account to the lock. So this effectively renders the lock completely inaccessible to the, you know, the legitimate owner, and it completely disappears from their app as if it never existed. So the code that we wrote was, it's simple Python code using the requests library everyone knows, I'm pretty sure everyone knows, written by Kenneth Reeds. So we just made those requests, we chained them into an exploit, made it all pretty using command line arguments and stuff. And that's it, we just made those requests using our own token because they never verified if the token and the user account actually match. And that's it, we own the lock. It was that simple. So now we're going to show you a proof of concept that we, you know, very expertly filmed.
So you can see two phones here. One is the victim and one is the attacker.
So the attacker doesn't have the lock on his app yet. So we run the code. We specify the ID and the MAC address. And that's it. It was that fast. So now once you restart the apps, you should see that the app, the lock will disappear from the current owner's app. And you should see it appear on the attacker. See, it says no locks.
It takes a while.
Yeah, there we go. The lock has been transferred. So now you hit unlock just for the sake of completion. Yeah. And the lock was unlocked. It was pretty simple, really.
Yeah, so.
So just to highlight a couple of other issues that we saw in the app during our you know, entire research, we found that there was an IDOR bug, indirect object reference, which allowed us to exfiltrate tons and tons of user data. So that we actually found this one endpoint which served profile photos of a lot of users, which is pretty scary to think of, right? So there's an endpoint which just, you know, serves a lot of users personal photos. And so when we started brute forcing the user IDs, right? So we increased the user IDs one by one we were able to access the user data of every other user on the platform. And we scripted this, and we found there are around 15,000 odd active locks in use. We found locks called garage, main door, work, and a bunch of others, which is a pretty scary thought to think of. You know, people out there are actually using this product without any, you know, knowledge of
how insecure
it is. Critical bugs that are, you know, the products are ridden with.
So we follow the textbook procedure for disclosure. We follow the responsible disclosure. So we sent multiple emails to the manufacturer regarding the vulnerability that we found and waited for 30 days to respond. And they responded with marketing emails and asked if we wanted to buy more of these locks.
Go figure.
Well, so the issue was found on 26 June while me and Anirudh were interning at Secure Layer 7. And on 27th, we notified the vendor. And on 2nd, we reserved our CVE ID. And
it is reserved. It's the first ever CVE we both got, so it's pretty special.
Yeah. The CVE ID was 2019-113-143. This CVE is basically registered under three names, me, Anirudh, and Shubham.
Shubham was the third guy who worked with us at Secure Layer 7 on this research. So shout out to him. He wasn't able to make it here. So yeah.
And finally on 2nd August, we made a public disclosure of this vulnerability. So everything is open to all.
Just a point I'd like to make. So we're not going to publicize the URL of the source code of this exploit. It can be trivially Googled, but we don't want to publicize it, mainly because we feel it's, you know,
unethical.
Yeah, unethical that, you know, people, the exploit is still active, right? You can, you know, break others' personal locks.
Which, yeah, and get others' personal details.
Yeah, personal account details. Everything is still publicly out there. But it's our job to publicize it, so we did. But you can look it up if you want to, you know, poke through the code, but we're not going to show the URL here. So yeah, that's it. I'd like to conclude by saying that, you know, smart devices, you can't just trust them, right? So IoT vendors are going to sell their product. They're going to claim it's all secure and stuff, but someone has to scrutinize it and, you know, point out these glaring holes that are there. No one's doing it yet. It's still IoT security research is really small. So don't implicitly trust these smart devices, right? And they bring about a huge attack surface into existing threat models, which and nobody even actually models in IoT as a part of their threat vector, right? So in enterprise security, nobody thinks IoT is a part of their threat vector. So people should update and factor in IoT and hardware as a potential attack surface as well. And in another issue is privacy concerns. So everyone voluntarily buys and installs wiretaps known as Google Home and Alexa. So Amazon is basically using this as you know, a way to steal your data, right? There's no better way to put it. And in totalitarian governments like in China, you see it being used for surveillance campaigns, or it can be potentially used for surveillance campaigns. I don't know, eyes are everywhere. Yeah. And yeah, I'd like to take this moment to, you know, call upon for more researchers in this space here, because, you know, it's going unchecked, right? So the entire IoT space is growing rapidly, and no one's really taking a quick, you know, closer look at the actual code or the actual security state that it is in. So we need more researchers here. And yeah, that's it. The slide everyone was waiting for, I'm sure. This is our online presence. Make sure to follow us. Yeah, you know what to do. Smash like, hit subscribe, whatnot. That's it. So I think we have a lot of time for questions. So if any.
Please pass the mic.
Anybody ask questions?